I'm trying this new thing. It's called being myself. And I used to change what I wore to leave the house, which nearly killed me, really, because I wouldn't leave the house worried about what people would think of me. And I thought I'd try this new thing. I've been trying this kind of new thing for a while now. This is all quite just hilarious. Because I have this thing where I think if my life was to really count, what would I be doing right now? That's something that I learned from Susan Jeffers in the book Feel the Fear and Do It Anyway. And when I thought about this talk and was rehearsing this talk, I was thinking of all the information that I want to tell you, and I wrote this whole thing, and then I thought, hang on a minute, what do I really want to do? What can I really do in this moment? One of them was turn up as myself, because I think it encourages other people to turn up as themselves, and I think that forcing people to be something they're not is one of the reasons that creates mental illness. I don't know if it's a British thing that we're quite sceptical about positivity. And when I feel fear now, I have a tool that I use that I can get over that fear. Well, not even get over that fear. I feel the fear and I laugh at it anyway. And so when I thought about what if my life matters and what would I be doing right here, right now, I wanted to talk to you about who I am right now. And I wanted to give you the tool that I have that I use when I'm nervous. And that is to laugh. I set myself challenges, really, really seem wacky challenges at the time. Like, one day, I might do a TED talk. Those challenges a while back were, one day, I might leave the house again. And do you know what? Sometimes, your one day becomes today. And here I am, doing a TED talk. But I thought, instead of talking about laughter and the science of laughter, I'm going to go into that briefly, but I thought the best thing that I can do right now is to show you. So, I don't know how many of you will be up for this, but I'm going to do it anyway. And I'm going to practice what I usually teach as a laughter facilitator. So what I want you to do is I want you to just relax into your seats. In fact, actually, this is my talk, and to be totally me, I'm going to sit down for this. I'll be bold and be myself. So, I want you to sit in your chairs, and I want you to just relax for a moment. Take a deep breath. And when I mean deep, I mean deep. I want you to really feel that coming up from the ground and in, and I want you to take a really deep, deep breath. Okay, next time I want you to allow your face to smile. It begins with a smile. Now, I thought that I'd walk on the stage and see all of your smiling faces at me, which would actually feed this process that I have. I can't actually see any of you because of the lights. So I'm going to assume that your smiles are beaming at me, okay? I want you to project your smile at me and beam it at me. So take a deep breath, smile. And then the next time, what I want you to do on your out breath, I'm going to do it and I'm going to invite you to join me. You don't have to, I'm going to do it. But I would really love it if you would do it too. So I'm going to smile. Medicine, and you just had an injection if you took part. Laughter, that kind of brain chemistry change, takes between 45 and 90 minutes, which is why I gave up standing up and doing stand-up comedy and started sitting down. Humour seems to be our only response to, the only way that we laugh is in humour. But some believe that it dates way back, and we used to do it as a primal response to fear. We don't do that anymore. We seem to need something else to make us laugh. And with that amount of chemicals going into your brain for just 1 minute, we need to be thinking more about laughing for the health of it. So in a laughter session, what I do now is I took it back a step and just laugh, breathing in and out, laughing. And everybody else ends up laughing for however long I'm doing it, really. The thing that I find interesting about that statistic is that in 2016, out of the £9.2 billion that the UK spent on medication, £266.6 million of that was antidepressants. Now, laughter isn't just a mind-changing thing. It's also a physiological thing. That chemical reaction soars through your body and changes your whole physiology. So the idea that I was thinking about, and the idea that I want to share, is how can we get that in everybody's day, where you just laugh for no reason at all? Well, not no reason at all, but, you know, for the health of it. Where you started your day, breathing in. You gave yourself that natural injection of serotonin, dopamine, oxytocin, and endorphins. You change your immune system, and you change the oxygen intake into your body. When you laugh generally as a practice like that every day, things start to change. Your sense of humor changes. Your attitude changes, because laughter, it increases your compassion, it changes how you see strangers, it changes your sense of humour, and everything becomes funny. So my idea and my challenge to myself that I might like to, that I'd like you all to think about really, is I wonder if we could add in 2 minutes of laughter in the same way that we add in 2 minutes of silence. When we have 2 minutes of silence to respect those that have fallen, I wonder if one day we could set our timers for 2 minutes and laugh together, collectively, to celebrate the living. When you use laughter as a practice, you do become quite sunny. And I wonder how that changed with us in evolution. Because my teachers are from other countries and they don't see this as weird. Although I've talked about my mental illness and curing my mental illness and had far stranger looks when I talk about joy and laughter. Even now, I'm not sure how many people actually did that exercise when I asked. Well, I can't actually see anyone. And I think that might be because nobody did it. So the reason that I got into laughter, I think, might help understand why it was so important for me to go in this direction. Many, many years ago, I was really struggling. When we talk about mental illness and when we talk about when people write things on Facebook and are positive, see, I think there was an example earlier that someone wrote something on Facebook that was positive and yet they'd been to the doctors that day and got some antidepressants. Now for me, that would have been a good day, because I would have got out of the house and I would have gone and got some help. And I think maybe we should shift what we do think about. I encourage my son to think of 5 positive things from his day so that he focuses on those. And those are the things that he will remember. Where I used to write about how bad I was feeling, I started writing about how good I was feeling. And that started when I started laughing every single day. And that whole process started when I did my course as a laughter facilitator. And the exercise that we were given at the beginning of that was to smile for 15 seconds in front of the mirror every single day. At the time, that was absolutely mad. I hated my reflection, I hated everything about me, but I did it. I smiled for 15 seconds every day. And now when I'm smiling, it's not a fake smile, because inside I'm laughing, silent laughter. So if you can't laugh aloud, maybe the thing that I can show you and teach you to take away from this talk would be to use that instead. So when we smile, we want to think of those chemicals that we're going to be generating. And they work whether you're laughing naturally or fake. And research into laughter has gone back decades. There are literally thousands and thousands of research papers into the health benefits of laughter. But we don't laugh enough. We should be laughing for 20 minutes to get those chemicals. And when you laugh fakely, it takes 2 minutes for it to become natural. So I wonder if you might like to think of practicing mindful smiling even. That's what something that I do. And that came about from my son noticing that everybody's faces were like this. And he'd been told, being autistic and having people trying to get him to understand that what people's emotions were by the looks of their faces, he was trained with emojis. So he was taught that anger was red face, eyebrows. He was taught that happy was and sad and confused was a straight smile. And he would say to me, "Are you okay, Mum?" "Yeah, I'm fine." "And why? Well, you look confused." I said, "What do you mean I look confused?" "So you look confused." I said, "I'm not confused, I'm just thinking." And I wondered how I could change that. And I looked around and I realised that that's everyone's also what we're going to have for dinner face, it's what we're going to do next week face, it's the, I'm totally relaxed face. And he thought that the whole world was miserable. And I told him that it's not really. So he went out into the world and he just wanted to cheer everyone up, same as I have. I've always just wanted to cheer people up. Because I think, if my life really counts, what would I be doing right now? And I think the smallest thing that I can do is share my smile. And I share my smile wherever I go. And I try and inject laughter in every single situation. And people tell me that it's cheered them up. People tell me that it made them feel better that day. But I think we need to think about how we can maintain that. And loneliness and depression is such a big problem. One of the things that I feel like we're disconnected with is ourselves. And one of the things that laughing in this way does is it connects you to your heart. That may sound like really far out there and a bit hippie. My son did suggest that I called this talk, it's all a bit hippie for me. I just want to end on a small story that I think might help someone else that's maybe in the audience or watching on a video. That when you give yourself challenges every day to leave the house and you believe that it's possible, you won't have to be in the same situation that I once was. At one point, after being homeless and struggling with the school, I thought, and my thinking was, that I was always going to be struggling and fighting for the support that my son needed in school. A relationship had broken down, things had just gone like from bad to worse, to good to bad, and I thought this was going to be the cycle and this was going to be my life. And I thought the only thing that I can do, my only solution, would be to kill myself. And I couldn't leave my son on his own, so I thought that the only thing that I could do was to kill us both. That happens. The reason I do what I do is because I don't want anyone feeling like that. So I text my friend at about 4 in the morning and I told him what I was thinking of doing, and I talked and cried and cried and cried and tried to convince him of all the reasons that I thought this was my only option. And at the end of that, he paused and he said, "You know what you need, don't you?" I said, "What? What do I need?" Anyway, "What you need is a little bit of Marmite round your ass." I knew him and I wasn't sure if he actually meant this or not. But what it taught me was the power of the brain-mind shift and how you can shift it. And if people haven't got friends, people are lonely, I want them to just close their eyes, smile, laugh anyway, and give themselves the injection they need. Thank you.